some level, we are all aware of how crucial and embedded humor or laughter is in our daily lives. The social media memes traffic indicates the sheer enormity of our consumption and creation of the funny on an everyday basis. And of course, it's not just the memes. There are so many things that we laugh at, and there are, in fact, so many ways in which we laugh. In his latest book, Humour, Terry Eagleton sets the stage of inquiry with this aspect, the fact of laughter being universal and yet not uniform. So, what constitutes the elements of humour or comedy? Why do we find certain things or situations funny or comic or witty? Why do we laugh and how do we laugh? Hello everyone, I am Nayan and welcome to the bookmark section of Galp Lok. I will be reviewing, as I just mentioned, the book Humour by Terry Eagleton. This book was published in 2019 by Yale University Press, but before I jump into the review of the book, let's talk a little bit about the author in case you haven't come across any of his previous works. So, Terry Eagleton is a celebrated British literary theorist, critic, and a public intellectual. He has written more than 40 books, and some of his most notable works are Literary Theory and an Introduction, The Ideology of the Aesthetic, and The Illusions of Postmodernism. There are many more. So, in one of his works, he argues that all literary theory is necessarily political. And we'll find this strain of thought in his current work as well, this engagement with the political. So his recent book, Humour, lies at the intersections of philosophy, literary criticism, critical studies, and cultural studies. I must admit that I have a social anthropological disciplinary background, and while I was vaguely aware of some works in the area of anthropology of humour, I had not read much on this topic, especially from a literary philosophical framework. So when I came across this book, I was quite interested about reading something new, and this book indeed does the work of a good introduction to the area. And some of the ideas presented in the book could be translated as well from one disciplinary framework to another. And in that sense, I found that the book speaks to a larger audience beyond its disciplinary context. Okay, without further delay, let's get into what the book is about. In this book, Eagleton seems to be engaging with two main guiding concerns, that is, how humor functions and the function of humor. The book draws on a wide range of literary texts and philosophical works, even anthropological and scientific accounts, and of course, a good many jokes. The book consists of 5 chapters. The first 3 chapters try to engage with the theories of how humor functions, and he mainly explains 3 dominant theories. The release theory, which takes more of a psychoanalytical approach articulated by Freud and others, it talks about humor and its relation with repression and release. The second theory that he discusses is the superiority theory, which follows the Hobbesian framework of understanding humor as coming from a place of superiority with an attempt to mock and ridicule. Incongruity theory comes out of the works of Francis Hudson and Kant and Schopenhauer, and it understands humor as arising out of situations of incongruity, that is, a sudden shift or momentary derailment of sense. So he discusses concepts such as bathos, which represents the sudden shift from the exalted to the everyday, from refined to brutish, which evokes laughter, and the idea of carnivalesque humor, which draws much from Mikhail Bakhtin's work. While the arguments in the book are not neatly streamlined to a certain extent, that is also what the author has to say about humor itself. It is messy. The inherent ambiguities and contradictions of humor make it difficult for any one theory to explain it. But as said before, Eagleton's concern is not only with understanding humor, but also its function. And it is here in the last 2 chapters that he turns towards this concern. The last 2 chapters being the history and humor and the politics of humor. One must note that the book is grounded in socio-historical contexts of Europe. However, that does not bar it from presenting certain insights that are kind of universal in their element. In the discussion on history and humor, the author shows how humor, comedy, wit, and other forms come into a socially mediated relationship of hierarchies and functions, and how it changes in different historical contexts. And I think this attention to the relationship between context and humor is important, as humor then provides an avenue to look at the prevailing forms of social material relations and the changes that come up with the changes in technology and spaces of socialization and expression. Rather than going into the details, I would just like to touch upon some themes that keep recurring throughout the text, which I also found interesting. The book looks at humor from the lens of mind-body relationship as well. Eagleton writes that while laughter can be representative of a bodily excess, a temporary disruption of all meaning through its own existence, it simultaneously carries a symbolic and cognitive element. In fact, humor, Eagleton writes, essentially requires an application of intellect. In the first chapter of the book, he talks in detail about the nature of laughter and what it entails for the mind-body question and how that impinges on the question of order. In chapter 4, History and Humor, he shows that historically, humor was often deemed to belong to the menial classes, framed predominantly as a bodily function. However, this was also rooted in a concern with order, as humor or comedy was seen to pose a threat to the sovereign power, not only because it was anarchic, but also because it rendered a certain lightness to matters as grave as suffering and death. There was an attempt to distinguish between refined laughter from brutish comedy, indicating the hierarchies of multiple forms in which laughter and humor is expressed. Humor in its political element can also be used as a mode of resistance and simultaneously as a method to contain resistance and contribute to the sustaining of order. In the chapter on the politics of humor, the author discusses the play Comedians by Trevor Griffith, and I really like the kind of questions that is put forth through its discussion. The linkage between humor and emancipatory politics, that is, humor as utopia and humor as critique. Whether the merger of their goals can find reconciliation without contradictions has been dealt with beautifully in this work. While the book looks into the politics of humor, I feel that Eagleton uses humor as a lens as well to look into the ambiguities of the political, to sort of explain the unintended chasm between the ethics of desired utopias and the implied ethics of emancipatory political action. And humor in this regard provides a philosophical ground to gauge the sheer humanness of such contradictions of our aspirations and actions. There's no conclusive argument in the book. The book in general is written in a reflective format and kind of in an entangled way. And yet the many ideas presented in the book can be illuminating in different directions. It brings in a lot of references and writings that one might not be familiar with. However, that does not disrupt the readability of the text. Although it engages with a number of philosophers and writers, the ideas remain quite accessible because of its writing. It is not stubbornly elusive. However, I must say something about the kind of expectations that one should or rather shouldn't come with while getting into the book. It does not provide an analysis of any of the recent forms of humor. It rather establishes humor as an object of socio-philosophical inquiry and articulates its implications and interactions with the political. This book is not pretentiously funny just because it is about humor, but it is fairly enjoyable. Thank you.